Can we turn this down a little bit? It's a little loud for me. I appreciate that. Glory goes to God.
That chord really looks like
a vibe. All right. Well, try not to be too distracting on that.
All right. All right. Well, good morning, church. Good morning, Green Assembly. I am so glad you guys are here today. My name is Pastor Courtney, and I am so glad to be here with you all. I come from Endicott, New York. I serve at Ignite Church in Endicott, and God has been doing a lot of amazing things there, and I'm assuming that God is doing some amazing things here because God is so good, right? And he always wants to lead, guide, and protect all his people. So as I was praying this morning and really feeling the Lord to, you know, I had a message and everything that I was ready to prepare, but God's like, I want you to add a little something to it. And I was like, oh. All right, so I pray that you guys give me a little patience and grace as I feel the Holy Spirit leading me to, you know, add a little bit of what he wants to speak to you guys today, and let's just hear from the Lord. Amen?
Amen?
All right, so let's just pray. Father God, have your way in this place. I know that you are here. I know that you are speaking. Your words do not return void. And Father God, I pray that every seed that goes out today, that it would be met with good soil. That the seed would go down into a good soil, and it would be a harvest of 30, 60, 100 fold, Father God. That you would just have your way in this place. If there's people here that feel this word and that they know that you are speaking to them, I pray that there would be a response, Father God, a willingness to follow you and to grow in their relationship with you. And let me not get in the way, Father God, of what you're doing in this place. And we give all this to you in your son's name. All God's people said.
Amen.
Amen. So today, I don't know how many of you guys are familiar with Jeremiah 29:13. How many of you guys are familiar with that? If you have your Bibles, go ahead and turn there. It's Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 13. And while you guys are getting there, I'm just going to speak to you guys from a day, from a place of what does it mean for us to be desperate for God? What does it mean for us to seek him and to find him? And what does he promise back to us that how he is faithful and what he will do as we are seeking him and his will for our lives? So Jeremiah 29 verse 13 says, "You will seek me and you will find me when you seek me with all your heart." That is a powerful word, one that I definitely feel spoken to me a few times where I was like, God, I want your plan, I want your direction, I want your will for my life, but God, how do I find it? How do I know that I'm following you and pleasing you in everything I say and do? And it comes right there in the answer of 29:13, "You will seek me and you will find me." That's me and God, that we are growing in our relationship with God every single moment. But it's not just I'm going to look for him and then it's going to be a little simple. No, it's an earnestness. It's a desperation. It's a heart that's hungering after the things of God. And that we know that when we are desperate for God, he promises us that we will find him when we seek him with all of our hearts. How many of you guys ever watched your kids or your grandkids ever play hide and seek before? Anybody here like that? Yeah, you see that? All right, so typically it starts off with all the kids hiding and one person is finding them. There's a lot of kids that they're found like this, really simply and really easy in about 5 seconds. And they're like, oh man, I already got found. But then like a minute goes by and 5 minutes goes by and there's still this one kid that hasn't been found yet. And so all the seeker is really starting to feel panicky and get desperate. And they're like, I don't know where this person is. They'll start asking their friends. And then sometimes the friends will cheat and tell them where that person is. But sometimes they will go to a teacher or a teenager or somebody in the room that say, hey, what can I do? I can't find this last person. I am desperate. So we do a lot of the same things in our own lives. That a lot of times when we are looking for a solution to something, that we're looking for reconciliation, or we're looking for something for God to move in, it really depends on where do we turn to that really reveals what our foundations are on. What our foundations are on. If our foundation is on other people, like family, well then we'll turn to them, right? Or sometimes if we have a medical diagnosis, I hear that we had a lot of people that needed some healing. So they might be going to doctors, and I'm desperate for a solution, for healing. But I also know this, that we can always turn to God in that desperation and say, God, I don't know how to get through this situation. I don't know how you're going to reconcile that, but please, God, make a way. And that's what our foundation is going to be on today. So my title of this message today is, Are You Desperate? So as I was considering what it meant to look like being desperate, I was thinking, God, what does it look like physically to be desperate for you? And what, God, what do you promise for us? So go from Jeremiah chapter 29. I want you guys to look at Psalms 23. You guys do that? Go ahead into the Bible and look at Psalms 23. I hope that you guys know a lot of this. This is a very familiar passage and one that I learned when I was about 5 years old. And I know that God has continually used that word in my life. So when you guys get there, just give me a heads up that you got it, or if you're like ready to quote it. However, Psalms 23. Amen. Amen. I see those hands. Thank you, Jesus. It says, the Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures, and he leads me beside quiet waters, and he refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, and my cup overflows. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. All right, so when we are desperate for God, what we are seeking, it really depends on what our foundations are. Psalms 23 starts off and saying, the Lord is my shepherd. Who is my shepherd? The Lord. Like I was saying earlier, sometimes family can be our foundations. Sometimes our jobs can be our foundations. Sometimes our relationships or the people around us can be our foundations. And sometimes even our past can be our foundation. But you know what all those things lead to? They lead to death. They lead to things that aren't from God. And at the end of the day, we can't seek God if we're looking towards other things. But as we are seeking God, as we're desperate for him, we put him as the shepherd in our life. When the Lord is my shepherd, when the Lord is your shepherd, the first promise is, you will lack nothing. You might think that you have nothing. You might think that, oh, I don't have enough food to last me this week, or I don't have enough money to get through this situation, or I don't know what to do. I don't have the wisdom. But the Word of God says, when the Lord is your shepherd, you lack nothing. I think that's a promise we can all take every day of our lives, amen? That when we are walking in the promises of God and when we put him first in our lives, that he will make sure we are taken care of. God takes care of his kids, amen?
Amen?
Amen. So the cool thing about this is that when we lack, when we have Jesus and we lack nothing, there's some more promises that he does in our lives. So verse 2 says, he makes me lie down in green pastures. Now, I love the whole part where we're walking in a field. You guys have plenty of them here, and there's green pastures everywhere, and you guys probably have a better understanding of what it takes to get to green pastures than I do because I'm from the city originally. But I love the first word, first three words. It says, he makes me. It's not just a, oh, he suggests. Or that he figures that he's like, oh, maybe they'll go over there. Maybe they'll wander that direction. No, he says, he makes me. Sometimes I want to get up and go. Sometimes I want to move, and I want to see God move in a situation. And God's just like, be still. Stay right here. Be in my presence. Read my word. Seek me. Be desperate for me. I'm going to make you lie down in green pastures. I don't know if you guys are people that like to move. You have a hard time sitting still. Anybody here like that? Hard time sitting still. And when I sit still, I start getting like, okay, this is weird. But God's like, I want you to sit, I want you to listen. You know, a lot of times we're always looking for God in the moving and like all the big hustle and bustle, the miraculous for housing. I've had that a few times in my life, you know what I mean? Where you, God, I need you to move in this situation right now, it needs to be big. And God's like, he has delivered in that times, but a lot of times he'll say, no, I need you to seek me. I need you right now to entrust me that I'm taking care of you and that you, when you put me as your shepherd, you will lack nothing. So I had to say, God, I'm just going to have to be still. I have to be still in this moment and say, I need you, Jesus. Only you are going to make this work. So the first thing that God does when we're seeking him is he makes us. He forms us. And he teaches us into the men and women that God wants us to be. Next thing he does is he leads me. So first thing he does is he makes me. He forms me in his image. Now he leads me. He leads, guides, and directs me that every place that I step my foot, that he should be the one before me. That he's the one in the situation before I even knew that it was going to come to pass. I encounter a lot of interruptions in my day-to-day job. So I work with special needs individuals, right? And when I am with them, sometimes I'll suggest something where, hey, can we go to a store? And or can we go to this friend's house? And that person will either say yes or no. And sometimes when they say no, it can get a little dicey. It can get a little chaotic. And a lot of times it doesn't always go well, but in those moments when the chaos hits, that's when I have to say, God, I don't know how to make this work. I don't know how to get this person to where they need to go. I don't know what to do to convince them that this is a good place for them to go. And God's just saying, let me lead. Let me guide you. Let me direct you. So he goes before those situations. And knowing that, how about this, when you guys were driving to church this morning, while I was driving here this morning, that I knew that God was already before me, he was already here working in this place, that he was already setting the atmosphere, and I'm just following, right? I'm just following him. So he's the one that leads, and he's the one that we get to follow. This is, of course, when we are desperate for him. The third thing that he does is he refreshes my soul. How many of you guys know we need peace in the world around us? That we need that peace that surpasses all understanding, and that when the world seems to get darker and darker and falls further and further away from God, that God's light shines brighter and brighter in that darkness. And we can have that peace knowing that he's the one that's on the throne, and no matter what people say around us and try to deter us from following him, at the end of the day, that he's the one that leads and guides, and he refreshes our souls. He satisfies our souls. When we are stuck in our, you know, understanding of how a situation might turn out or how our country is going to, you know, turn out, it's an election year, that we can still know that he is the one that's on the throne, that he is the one that's going to take care of his kids, and that he will refresh our souls.
Amen.
And then the other thing, the last thing that he does in verse 3, it says, he guides me along bright paths for his name's sake. He is the one that leads, guides, and directs, right? So if you're in a situation where you're like, God, I don't know if I'm supposed to go left or if I'm supposed to go right, if I'm supposed to pick this job or another one, or if, you know, if I'm supposed to reconcile with a family member, that he's the one that guides along the right path. He's the one who already knows the outcome because he's already been there. He's already seen how this is going to work. And so at the end of the day, we're the ones following his direction. We're the ones following his guidance.
And he is the one that's going to bring us the right path,
but not just for our good,
for his glory.
At first, it's for his glory, for all the people around us. I think about this. You guys, are you familiar with the story when Jesus is on the boat, and all the disciples are on the boat, and Jesus is sleeping, and all the disciples are freaking out, saying, I don't know how this is going to work. I think this boat is going to sink. And they're crying out, and Jesus is sleeping. And the crazy part about it is, if you read in Mark 4, there was other little boats right there, seeing how they react to a storm in their life, seeing how when there's adversity, when there's situations that arise, that all the other people in the little boats saw how Jesus' followers reacted. And Jesus, immediately when he wakes up, he's like, listen, don't you have enough faith in me? That you've seen me do some miracles before, you've seen me be faithful before. But at the end of the day, they still got scared. So Jesus brought peace. Amen. Said, peace, be still. And that's when not just the disciples believed, but all those people in the little boats also saw what Jesus could do and how he was taking care of them. At the end of the day, that's what brought honor and glory to God. It wasn't just for the disciples. It wasn't just for the other people in the boats, but it was to bring glory to God. Are we making decisions that honor God, that show that we trust him? You know, Proverbs 3, 5, and 6 talks about trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, submit to him, and he will make your path straight. Are we truly able to say, I trust you, Jesus. I trust you, Father God, with these situations, and I know that you're going to be the one that brings a good outcome for your glory and for my good, because he takes care of his kids. So, I know this is a little bit of a shorter word, but at the end of the day, I want to see God magnified in each of our lives. And yes, we have a smaller congregation here, but you know what? Jesus had 12. And then there's still 2,000 years later that God is still using that, what they set in motion, for the rest of us so that we can see God's glory revealed. And the church has been thriving and establishing all over America and all over the world. So I pray that today that we would get hungry for God, that we would get desperate for him, and that we would say, God, I don't know how to handle this situation, but you do. So please, God, give me wisdom. James chapter 1, verse 5 says, if you are lacking wisdom, that God will give it to all without finding fault. That he will on and always give the wisdom when we ask him, and that when we are ready to hear it and receive it, and the crazy part is that we also need to walk in it. When God shows us that we need to do something, that we would be the hands and feet of Jesus, that we get to be used by God. And he's the one who's going to get the glory and the honor and the praise. Amen. So I just want to close with this, guys. And I pray that you would just let the Holy Spirit speak to you and minister to you. If there's anything here that you are dealing with, any situations that you are unsure of what God is going to do and how he wants to move in that, I pray that we would just lay that at Jesus' feet. That all the things that we are going through, that's really, at the end of the day, it's an opportunity for us to grow closer to him and to bring honor to him. Because he's already got the wisdom. He already knows the outcomes on what's going to happen. So let me just pray, and I'm going to pray a blessing over all of us. Father God, I know that you are so, so good, Father God, and that you're the one who speaks. You're the one who guides, Father God. That when you are the shepherd and the Lord of our lives, that we lack nothing. So I pray that we would trust you with all of our beings, and that we would honor you, Father God, and walk in the ways that you would have us to walk, Father God. Let us not do things in our own understanding, but God, let it be with your mindset and with your wisdom, Father God. If there's anybody here going through a situation that they don't know how it's going to come about or how it's going to work out, Father God, I pray that you would give them the wisdom right now, Father God. And also, if you are using this to grow our trust in you, to grow in our relationship with you, Father God, I pray that you would just let that happen, that we would trust you, whether or not we have a solution. But God, we have the author and perfecter of faith, of life. That you started it, you will bring it to pass, Father God. And we give all of our time to you and our thoughts to you, Father God. And we just give this day to you. And all God's people said,
amen.
Amen. I would love to pray with any of you if you would like to come forward. If there's any other elders in here that also feel led to pray. I'd love to pray for each and every one of you, because I know that God is speaking, that he wants to do something in your life and he wants to show you. So if I can pray for you, I'll be happy to do that. But God bless you guys.
Amen. Amen.